Everybody, let's really rock.
I don't think any one person started rock and roll. As a matter of fact, the rock and roll that I understand is rock and roll. I'm positive they didn't. Now, I do believe one man popularized and identified the name rock and roll. And believe me, this goes to Alan Freed.
We heard about the incidents throughout the country and the coming of this concert to Jersey City. I asked our Commissioner of Public Safety, Lawrence Whipple, to look into the matter, and he did make a survey of the situation.
My department made a very thorough investigation of these so-called programs. We had telephone conversations and correspondence with various municipalities, included among these being Hartford, Connecticut, Orange, New Jersey, Asbury Park, and the city of Hoboken. And we find that these programs are not for the good of the community, and that's why I ordered them banned.
Frankie Lyman was the lead singer of a group called The Teenagers back in the 50s. A young singer who unfortunately died too young, had too many wives, and did a few too many drugs, and didn't exactly reach the full potential of his life. And it's a somewhat of a uplifting but also a tragic story.
Was Frankie Lyman. A lot of older people knew who he was, and it's really interesting that they also, a couple of people who knew him and remember him, and they're like, man, that guy was like gonna be like Michael Jackson. I'm so glad it's you, I won. I'm so glad
you wanna meet you, baby. Frankie Lyman was the original person that sang Why Do Fools Fall in Love. So this is what's wonderful about this film, is that we have a chance to educate people about Frankie Lyman and a little bit of our music history.
When an entertainer has a financial interest in something that he's selling to the public, he ought to say so.
I'd love to answer all your questions, fellas. You know, I'd like to be nice, but my attorney doesn't want me to say a thing. I'm trying my best. I just can't say. I'm under subpoena here.
Now listening to Rock Around the Clock. This is the theme music from MGM's sensational new picture, Blackboard Jungle. Many people said the story could not, must not, dared not be shown. The picture already has the movie and book world gasping. Blackboard Jungle deals with an explosive subject, the teenage terror in the schools. It is the frankest, the toughest, the most realistic film since On the Waterfront. It is fiction, but fiction torn from big city modern savagery. It packs a brass knuckle punch in its startling revelation of those teenage savages who turned big city schools into a clawing jungle. Black Forest Jungle will be the talk of this town. Don't miss it.
Blackboard Jungle at the time was a rather shocking film. I enjoyed, of course, working with Glenn Ford.
Turn off the lights.
Frank.
The lights.
No matter what happens, I love you. I was silly and vain and selfish, so I doubted you. I was like one of the bad kids in your class. Somebody told me a lie, and I believed that lie. One's as bad as the other.
So I want to tell you something.
I was wrong about something else, too.
The film itself, of course, was quite a startling, scary film, because Blackboard Jungle, as you know, was about gangs in schools, and only this was back in the 50s. Time I can remember when it was released or being released, that Hedda Hopper was very, very upset about it, and she felt that it was communist inspired, and to try to break down, you know, our country, and that it should not be taken abroad to the film festivals abroad, because it would be feeding into the communist hand, saying, showing that the American school system and the American kids were all a mess. So there was a tremendous upheaval about that particular film, politically.
But you see, this is my classroom, and you're in it. And what I could teach you, first lesson is don't put in. Don't. Because just flunk out for good.
And of course it was the instigating factor for rock and roll with Bill Haley and with Rock Around the Clock. Blackboard Jungle did have quite an influence on our country, as far as shaking people up quite a bit in many ways.
With Clark Gable, it's called Teacher's Pet. It was done at Paramount, and that was probably the most exciting movie I've done.
Flaming Mamie Van Doren, giving lessons in anatomy.
Oh, I'm the girl who invented rock and roll.
But my very favorite was called Untamed Youth, in which I played sort of a juvenile delinquent in the 70s. It was sort of the beginning of rock and roll. Mm-hmm. And I was considered then a sort of a female Elvis Presley.
But you should be told, even with a blazing fire, you would leave me cold. But you're a slimy baby as a salamander, slip and slide away.
I sang rock and roll and a lot of movements. In those days, you didn't, you know, women weren't considered to be moved. They had to sit on a piano or stand still and sing. Well, I always wanted to move.
Mamie Van Doren, the Tallahassee Tassel Tosser.
I still want to move, so.
Don't you treat me wrong. Come and love your mama all night long. Come on, baby, see about me.
held her own. I was born reckless.
Mamie Van Doren, America's number one sex kitten.
A woman can't help being a woman.
Well, you don't have to be so darn much of a one. You make every woman in the world feel positively flat-chested. You're a menace, that's what you are.
The Hayes office and the Johnson office were always hanging around when I did anything. See if I had cleavage or, you know, if I did a forward bump.
Oh, I'm the girl who invented rock and roll.
He saw me in Warner Brothers, and Clark saw me and wanted me to play a role.
He's a gal who's a real solid sender. And what have you got?
Hadn't he been married and I had to been married, you know, there were definitely sparks. I was 24 and he was like in his, like, early 60s.
What is this?
We had like a teenage necking in the dressing room, but he's very shy. He was a man's man.
That you love me.
The battle of the sex kittens begins. The old profs regain their lost youth.
Tally-ho!
And everyone has a ball.
Oh, thank you.
Including Mickey Shaughnessy.
Well, me, Boomy.
Boomy?
Yeah.
Mafia, 36.
Why do we call it 38? I remember.
I got a gal, Miss Mamie is her name. She don't love me, but I love her just the same.
Honey? Magnetic Mamie has them all hypnotized.
You are going to sleep. You are going to sleep. You will do what I tell you. You will do what I tell you. Sleep!
Don't touch that thing, lady! Don't touch that thing!
You mean to say you haven't any money left from your allowance?
I didn't mean to tell you, but you found out anyway.
I thought you were going to keep a budget.
I did, but it didn't stay kept.
May I say it? Uh-huh. Ice cream, candy, magazines, jukebox, 40 cents, EP, 60 cents. EP, what's that?
Elvis Presley.
The eye can see, a press of excited youngsters from all over the region are on hand for the return of Elvis Presley to Tupelo, Mississippi, the town where he was born. A phenomenon recalling Marilyn Monroe's sensational debut in show business, Mr. Teenager is on his way to attaining a popularity unparalleled in theater history. Hear this, all ye young at heart. The handsome king of rock and roll will soon be seen in his first picture titled Love Me Tender. It's a CinemaScope attraction with Richard Egan and Deborah Padgett that will be released during the Thanksgiving holiday period. And in it, he proves to be as naturally talented as a dramatic actor as he is as a singing entertainer. His parents here with him share all of his successes, and Elvis is never too busy to oblige his young admirer.
Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, you ain't no friend of mine.
tell you something. Incidentally, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think that I'm revealing any secrets when I say that Elvis Presley is the fastest rising young singer in the entertainment industry today.
Elvis was my friend first and my boss second. He was a wonderful person, very considerate, very generous, with giving things, paid for everything, and he was just a nice guy. He liked people to enjoy his money with him. Elvis, when he was young, didn't have too many friends. He was always a strange kid in high school and in his neighborhood. He was the one with long hair and the weird clothes. Everybody else wore t-shirts and crew cuts. So he didn't have too many friends when he was young. So when he became a success, naturally he knew he attracted friends and he wanted friends around him, and that's what it was. I think he was trying to make up for his younger years. But I miss Elvis. There'll never be another Elvis.
Elvis, there have been a lot of rumors about your love life. Did you meet anyone special in Germany?
Not any special one. There was a little girl that I was seeing quite often over there that her father was in the Air Force, and actually they only got over there about 2 months before I left. I was seeing her, and she was at the train at the airport when I left, and there were some pictures made of her, but it was no big romance.
You can't do anything on your own without somebody watching over you and making a story up about you.
Well, let's face the facts. Anybody that's in the public eye is, their life is never private. I mean, everything you do, the public knows about it, and that's the way it's always been, that's the way it'll always be.
Elvis, smile for me!
We went on location in Seattle, and it happened at the World's Fair. There were tens of thousands of people trying to get in the hotel. I mean, that was a real phenomenon. It was like the Beatles.
As far as the acting and as far as singing and all, you're on your own. I mean, nobody tells you how to do that.
He wanted to become a director in movies. He wanted to direct comedies, action movies, because he loved action and comedy. One time we were, I rented this big house for Elvis in Bel Air, California, back in 1961. Beautiful house, big swimming pool in the backyard. So we're sitting around the pool one day, and he says, well, somebody had a camera. They dropped the flash bulb, the old flash bulb cameras in those days, into the pool. It was floating on top of the water. He said, get me a BB gun. I have a BB gun in the house. Go get it. He goes, and he shoots at this thing, and it exploded, because at those times, those flash bulbs did that. He said, throw some more in there. So he said, there, he starts shooting these things. So he said, this is fun. Go out and buy some BB guns. Go get a bunch of them. Get a lot of EVs, and get a bunch of flash bulbs. So we started target practicing. Now this stuff is all blowing up, it's sinking to the bottom of the pool. Well, we went from flash bulbs to little floating boats to little battery operated boats. We started blowing up everything inside the swimming pool. And by that evening, the bottom of the pool must have had about 6 inches of junk in the bottom of it. But that's just what he was crazy about, those things. He didn't realize. It took me 4 days to get the pool clean. It cost me about $600 to have it cleaned after that. And we spent about $1,000 in junk to do this, but he loved to do this kind of stuff. Elvis was a compulsive person. He would buy things on a whim. And then when he bought something, he'd buy it for everybody else too. If he bought a new car, and he said, well, I think my friends need new cars too, so he'd buy everybody a new car. And he would do this periodically with a lot of things, jewelry, cars, horses, trucks, and everything he did. That's the way he was. I was in Vail, Colorado with Elvis, and we were there on a vacation having a good time. We had a couple police officer friends up there with us, and he said, Joe, I think these guys need a couple new cars. So he said, okay. So I call up the dealership down in the middle, late at night. We drive all the way down to Denver from Vail. We bring these two police officers with us, and he goes and he buys one a brand new Lincoln Continental and the other one a brand new Eldorado. And while I was there, he said, Joe, look at that Rolls Royce. Wouldn't you like that? I says, no, I don't want that car. I says, I'll cause trouble in the group, and I don't want you to go out and buy 10 Rolls Royces. So he said, I got to get you something. I said, don't give me anything. Just give my girlfriend Shirley. She doesn't have a car. He gave her a brand new Eldorado. That's just the way he was. He just loved to do those things because he knew people could not afford to do it for themselves. So this way he felt good about doing it. It made him feel good.
One day I was sitting in Colonel Tom's office at MGM, and I was getting ready to sign my contract, and Time magazine called, and they were asking for permission to put Elvis on the cover of Time magazine, and Colonel Tom said, well, fine, that'll be $25,000. And Time Magazine supposedly said, "You don't understand, we'll help. We're a big help." And Colonel Tom said, "You don't understand. We don't need your help." Now, I don't know if Elvis was ever on the cover of Time Magazine, but I know in that instance he was not. I think Elvis was one of the few people who could afford to have that sort of representation. And Colonel Tom was certainly one of those who could say that and get away with it. I don't think I've ever worked on a project that has been as much fun as Harum Scarum, which was directed by Gene Nelson, the dancer Gene Nelson. And we didn't shoot it on the MGM lot, and I'm trying to remember where we actually shot it. We used a set that had been done from one of these Lawrence of Arabia type movies in the past, and the set was already in existence. So they had to write a story to fit the set. And it said, Princess Shalimar, that was my character, gallops across the landscape with her long hair and veils and flying in the wind, riding a white Arabian stallion. So I arrived on the set, and I must have had 17 pounds of false hair. I mean, I had hair that went down to my waist, and it was so good for my posture because it made me hold my head up. And I must have had 14,000 yards of orange chiffon. I was paid money to dress up in these wonderful costumes and just have fun all day.
With dancing girls at your command. Go eat and drink and feast, go east young.
And then Elvis would come in. And there would be a magic that would happen. I mean, there would be an electricity that would happen on the soundstage that everyone was aware of. I don't think anyone could really analyze it and tell you to this day what it was. Elvis certainly didn't understand it. I mean, he understood if he moved certain ways that he would get a reaction. I mean, he's not stupid. But, I mean, I don't think he really understood his true gift.
Jing-a-ling-a-ling, shake, shake one of the dancing queens. That tambourine, every pretty girl's gonna know I'm around. They're gonna know I'm in town.
Elvis was wonderful to work with. He was a gentleman. He stood up when I entered the set. He would say, "Where's Marion's chair?" One of the boys said, "Damn," in front of me, and he said, "Please never cuss in front of a lady." He put women in two categories. You were either on a pedestal or you were not on the pedestal.
I found when he stopped touring and he was doing the movies just for the millions of dollars per movie they gave him, I think his heart and soul wasn't into it. And there might have been a good performance here or there, but in general, I found that none of them matched the earlier stuff.
Return to sender. Return to sender. I gave a letter to the postman. He put it in his sack. Bright and early next morning, he brought my letter back. When a boy like me meets a girl like you.
Girls, girls, girls. It's a storm of entertainment that brings down the house. The greatest of all, the Elvis Presley musicals, with a whole album full of brand new songs.
Angel walk on street. Earth boy walking too. All at once they meet. Ooh.
The salty story of a two-fisted guy who wanted to own his own boat more than anything in the world, while every girl on the shore was trying to own him.
I Don Juan and Casanova rolled into one. But in the boat, it's girls. Girls, girls, girls.
I couldn't stand being fooled again. It's me, and it is real, isn't it?
better one to get tied down with a girl like you. I don't want to love you, but I do. If I should live to be 90, I will never forget it. The little shrimp and the song he sang as he jumped into the net.
Well, there ain't nothing I can do. I'm gonna play the field.
Feel the love is wild, but I don't wanna be tired. I'm just a red-blooded boy.
It wasn't until the 68 comeback that he became as good as he ever was. When he did the 68 television special, and then I started appearing live again in 69.
When he started back in 69, when we opened up in Las Vegas, he hadn't performed in 8 years. And in Vegas, the first time, he failed because people didn't care for him in Vegas that time. But in 69, when he walked on that stage and I saw that audience give him a standing ovation, all these big invited guests, which usually just sit and don't move, there were all these people from show business all standing up applauding him, and you could just see the look on his face. He was just so, felt so good that he was received this way. And they stood up through almost the whole show. He walked off that stage, he must have been 10 feet off the ground. He was so thrilled. You just saw tears in his eyes because he was so thrilled. And that was, I get goosebumps thinking about it right now, in fact. So that was a very, very exciting moment for me. And then the Aloha from Hawaii special, live around the world by satellite. I mean, these are events that nobody else ever did before. He did. He took it. He went out and did it at heart. And I was excited that when he got married, I was the best man at his wedding. That was a thrill, a big highlight of my life with him. There's a lot of different events. There's not one specifically one that stands out. I had a lot of great events with Elvis, and I have a lot of great memories. I actually got to know Gene Vincent in the late 60s. Gene was great. And unfortunately, Gene really only had one big hit, which was his first one, Bebopalula. I mean, he had some minor records, like Lot of Lovin' and a few afterwards. And the problem with Gene was, he looked the part, he sounded the part, but he really wasn't the part he was tried to play. I mean, he was a real nice guy. I mean, he was like... he was a really shy guy, and he was always cast as this dark, threatening El Greco type of rocker. And I think he really had a hard time in living up to that. He did a few acting things, most notably Hot Rod Gang.
The hottest of hot rodders, the craziest of kittens, high school Hellcats, two terrific teenage movies.
What the hell cat she going, man?
And the rockinest, rollinest of cats, starring popular John Ashley, cute little Jodie Fair, satellite siren Gene Vincent, and that alarmingly charming Yvonne Lyme, a kitten who has all the cats howling.
She wasn't bad looking for a girl. Personally, I prefer a hopped-up motor.
Guys who've got what it takes. Chicks who'll take all they've got. Together in two movie theater treats. Hot Rod Gang and High School Hellcat.
In the late 50s, when rock was sort of dying out here, He and Eddie Cochran went over to London because the Brits really appreciated our rock and rollers a lot more than we did at that time.
Cotton picking record of the year.
Well, I certainly
know he's right. Good ball, but he's the pass on to Pasquale. Well, Jerry, yes, sir, we're going to have old Jerry Lewis back in just a minute. Jerry Lee Lewis with the greatest record I think he's ever recorded. Great balls of fire. We'll see you next fall, Jerry, okay?
All right, Mr.
Go out and get you a cold bottle of Coca-Cola.
Thank you.
Hit it.
Yeah.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain.
Now, the funny thing about Jerry Lee is his cousin is Jimmy Swaggart. And I think Jerry Lee always had a problem of balancing the devil's music with, getting right with God. And I think it actually drove him a little crazier than he was already. I think he found it a real problem with that, because he knew he was singing the devil's music and always felt a little guilty about it. And, he came from that, really religious Southern background. Although he comes from such a crazy family. I remember when Nick Tosh's did the great biography on him called Hellfire, he traces Jerry Lee Lewis's family back to the first settlers of Faraday, Louisiana. And Nick says, the kind of people that the Indians were embarrassed to be seen with. Tavern called Cook's Hoedown Club in Houston, and that was before Elvis had broken out of Memphis. And I was 12 and playing rhythm guitar for a man named Gabe Tucker, who ran and owned the band that I was playing rhythm guitar for and singing a couple of songs. I was just changing from being a little boy to going into puberty. And girls were beginning to find me very, very attractive. The girls that go to Cook's Hoedown, now they are girls that you don't ask for dates and spend a year courting and buying candy for and picking them up at the prom. They're girls that want to get it all done in one night, and then if it's good, go back and do it and do it and do it and do it 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 again and again and again. Well, these girls started coming over to me and playing around with me. They'd lift their skirts and they'd wear nothing under them and they'd pull down a bra. They'd say, "Are you old enough to feel anything, Tommy?" I can't do an imitation of a girl. And I would say, "Oh yeah, I'm feeling something." "Well, where is it?" Well, you know where it is. And so I started going out with those girls, and they started making my life just a dream. The dream I had all, because I was a horny little mother from the age of 5 when I first saw Sheena, Queen of the Jungle. Oh, Irish McCullough. If I had lived in a different time, I would have fought wars to meet you, woo you, and take you away to the jungle, and you would be mine forever. I just loved her. Anyway, all the women that I liked after that, they didn't all have blonde hair and big greenish blue eyes, but they all had great bodies, you know. And so you want to hear this, the time which kind of dovetails in that same time frame, about the night that Elvis Presley saved my life by not killing me? Okay. I was in Houston, and I had worked with Elvis by then, and we were living above a hamburger shack, and my mom was working all day for $32 a week as a sales girl in Foley's in Houston, Foley's department store. So I was alone all day, and these girls that lived downstairs started coming around and coming up and teasing me and playing around with me. But there was this one that was older than the two younger sisters. And I'll just call her now because I can't remember her name. I'll call her Betty. And Betty would tease me just to the brink. And I'd be going, oh. And she just French kissed me and rubbed my legs and my crotch and pulled up her. She already had on these Daisy Mae jeans. They were as high as you could go without exposing yourself. She'd pull them up a little more, and then she'd turn around and pose like Betty Page, who was the big sex queen during the early 50s in modern detective magazines of all things. And she'd pull up the back and this and that. Well, we cut now to about a year later, and I'm playing the Louisiana Hayride up in Shreveport, Louisiana. And I'm waiting to go on, and all of a sudden, I get hit on the shoulder, which he always did. I was Elvis. He'd give me a bump or a punch, slight punch on the shoulder. He'd say, "Hey there, little guy. Hey, little T. How you doing? I want you to meet my girl here, Betty." And I turned and I went, and he said, "Yeah, she is pretty, isn't she?" He didn't know what the reaction was that I was showing him. He said, "Yeah, she is pretty, isn't she?" She said, "You keep your cotton-picking, horny little hands off her. You understand? I'm going on now." I said, "Elvis, I'm supposed to go on now." He said, "Well, when I get here, I get here, and when I get here, I go on, because I want to get out of here, and me and Betty got some stuff to take care of." So he goes on, kills the people. Meanwhile, Betty is standing there, and she's kissing my ear and French kissing. "I'm going, take your hands off me. Get away from me. You'll kill me." She grabs my hand, takes me downstairs, takes me into Elvis's pink Cadillac, his pride and joy. We get in the front seat. She closes the door, and she starts from my forehead to my eyes to my nose to my lips, tongue, you know, just. And all of a sudden I hear boom, and I go, "Oh God, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done." I know I'm dead. I look over, and there he is. He's towering above the car. And he looks at me, and he doesn't look at her. He says, "Get out, boy." Well, I got out, and I'm just standing there looking up at him. And he says, after a long time, with those deep, you know, eyelashed, reset dark eyes with the natural mascara look to them, he's looking down at me, and he's gone, he goes, "Get out of here, little boy." And I ran and ran back up the stairs to the hayride. Later, I go where all the hayride people go for hamburgers afterwards. I'm sitting there with some of the players, a guy named Tillman Franks, who was one of my best friends and one of my first encouragers in this business. And he's still alive, still in Shreveport, still managing some people. Tillman, thank you, too. And your whole family. And Tillman and I are sitting there with a couple other guys, and in walks Elvis. I can sense him out of the corner of my eye, and I look over, and oh my God, here comes Elvis and Betty, and they sit right in front of a pillar,
and I'm trying to keep my eyes from him. And finally, I have to look up because I feel that he's looking at me. And he goes, like, and there's nothing there but the men's room. So I get up and I repeat my sacraments again. And I walk in. When I get there, he's looking in the mirror. He was the only guy I knew that combed perfect ducktails. Perfect. They were long and they were just perfect. And he had his hair done. But from me, I have to admit, and I'm proud of this, he stole one thing, and that was the permanent wave that the girls downstairs who owned the beauty shop used to put in my hair to keep it from falling straight in my eyes. And so he got one. In fact, if you look around, Elvis Presley fans, you'll find one circa 1957 or 56, and you'll notice curls in his hair. It's a great picture. Anyway, I go in, he's combing ducktails in the mirror, but looking at me too. And he turns around and looks down at me, and he gets that wry, I can't do that. The side of the face smirk that he gets on his face. He said, boy, you and me are friends. Don't you know that? He said, I love you like a little brother, Tommy. He said, I would never mess that up for a woman, for a girl. She's pretty and she's real nice and I like her a lot. But he said, I ain't gonna blow you and me over her. He said, don't worry about it. I was just kidding you. And he gives me a light tap, at which point I go all the way to the back of the bathroom. You know, he's so big and strong. And he says, now get out of here. I go back and I'm feeling like $1 million. And that was the night that he saved my life by not taking it.
Who couldn't catch her with his car? Well, here he is to tell us all about it with a brand new automobile, Chuck Berry, and you can't catch me.
Swingin' singer doing Johnny B. Goode, his latest hit, plus the greatest, Maybelline.
Oh, Maybelline! Oh,
it started back in 1954 when I was touring the country, and I stopped here in Chicago and I heard Muddy Waters playing at what was called the Palladium and on State Street, and I sat and listened to him and got groovy, you know, listening to Muddy, and I asked him, how do you get into records, as I have been asked many times. So he said, well, go over and see Lynn Chess and see if we can arrange something with him. And I did this the following morning, as I had a 3 or 4 day vacation. And Leonard Chess told me to, well, let me hear some of your material. And I said, should I bring the band up? He said, well, just bring some recordings up that you have. This, at that time, was a home recording that I had that we had been talking about. And I brought it up 2 weeks later. And on this tape, I had Maybelline, Wee Wee Hours, and I can't recall now the others. But these two, he chose off the tape and told me to bring the band back. I did this, and we recorded on professional material, and he and Maybelline, of course, you know the rest. After it was put out in '55, May of '55, that is.
The great thing about rock and roll, when it started, and even today, is it is the art of teenage America. It is the number one way of, for teenagers to communicate a common bond. I mean, it is a tribal thing for young America. I mean, it's like, it was our music. When I grew up, as a teenager, you're going through this, you know, the constant angst of not fitting in, of not being developed, of not knowing what you are. And rock and roll told us what we were. Rock and roll taught us about girls and taught us about sex and taught us about what to wear and taught us everything. Basically, a lot of us kids ate, lived, and breathed rock and roll. I mean, it was like more important to us than television, more important than books, more important. School days to me was Chuck Berry's school days.
Rock and roll started over 40 years ago and continues to this day. And Hollywood has been there to capture it all, making cinematic stars out of such rebel rockers as Elvis, Little Richard, and Jerry Lee Lewis.
You're fine. So kind. Wanna tell the world that you're mine.
Hollywood immortalized legends and made stars out of those who portrayed them. From the moment rock and roll hit the big screen, a new generation was born with a lifestyle and lingo all its own.
Just a beast.
Join Hollywood in its salute to the history of rock and roll in the movies.
Hey, sister, what do you call that exercise you get?
It's rock and roll, brother, and we're rocking tonight.
Rock it on Tuesday, Wednesday,
but you're never gonna stop rock and roll, don't you know that?
In 1951, a 29-year-old disc jockey named Bill Haley was enjoying moderate success with his band, the Down Homers. Most of their early recordings had been hillbilly novelty songs and cover versions of various country western hits. By 1952, the band underwent several name changes, finally settling on Bill Haley and his Comets. Their musical style began to change as well, with Haley combining his country and western roots with old-fashioned rhythm and blues, creating a more slick, faster, and wilder sound. Though he didn't know it at the time, this was the beginning of a new musical style that would soon shake, rattle, and roll across the globe.
She said, "I'm sorry, pretty guy."
In 1954, he recorded Rock Around the Clock.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock.
The song never caught on with record buyers and seemed doomed to obscurity. But out in Hollywood, California, there was one person who was listening. Motion picture director Richard Brooks was working on a film called Blackboard Jungle, which starred Glenn Ford as a high school teacher battling a gang of juvenile delinquents at an inner city slum. Brooks felt that the song fit the wild and reckless tone of the film.
You are now listening to Rock Around the Clock. This is the theme music from MGM's sensational new picture, Blackboard Jungle. Many people said the story could not, must not, dared not be shown. It packs a brass knuckle punch in its startling revelation of those teenage savages who turned big city schools into a clawing jungle. Don't miss it.
The first use of rock and roll in film was this movie, Blackboard Jungle. And that movie actually caused riots in Europe. The movie started with Rock Around the Clock. You know, it's like that 1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock rock. It was so such a driven sound, and it was like a professional movie that didn't rely on rock and roll or didn't rely on camera rock and roll. But the rock and roll soundtrack is what drove that movie. And the good news was that basically it brought rock and roll around the world instantly. And the bad news was that because the movie was about juvenile delinquents, it basically irrevocably tied rock and roll to juvenile delinquency, which was an unfair rep.
Blackboard Jungle breathed new life into the song, and soon Rock Around the Clock exploded onto the top 10. In theaters across America, teens were going wild. Never before had music in a film had such a wide-reaching effect on modern culture.
Rock and roll is cool, Daddy, and you know it.
That music sends me, man. It sends me. You guys dig that music all the way.
That was crazy music, man. That sends me, Jack.
The Moondog Show.
Hi, everybody. How are you all? This is yours, truly, Alan Freed.
Rock and roll had caught on fire. The man who created the spark and fanned the flames was Cleveland disc jockey Alan Freed. It started at Cleveland's WJW radio station on Freed's Moondog Show when he began spinning black R&B records to his predominantly white audience. The show became a hit. Freed was the visionary who almost single-handedly transformed America's musical tastes by integrating the radio airwaves for white and black audiences alike. New York called, with the opportunity to bring rock and roll to a much larger audience. Freed took his Moondog Show to 1010 WINS. Freed found a way to take the rock and roll trend one step further. He began producing live concert shows in movie theaters with some of the biggest R&B acts around, whose roots were a vital part of rock and roll.
Luckily, I was in New York in 1957 and got to go to a couple of the Alan Freed rock shows. And I remember the first one was Buddy Holly, Clyde McFadder, Big Joe Turner, Johnny and Joe, the Everly Brothers. I mean, it was an amazing show. And that was my first experience with a major interracial situation. The audience basically was about half black and half white, and that was my first experience of being around a lot of black people, and it was a pleasure. We were all just kids. I mean, there was never one racial incident. I mean, we're all just kids who loved rock and roll, and it was like, I mean, that taught me a lot.
These live shows would be Alan Freed's first step on the road to Hollywood, where he broke the rules by featuring both black and white musical acts in the same film, a bold move in 1956.
Nail down the roof, gang, because here's a new act that could blow it right off. The sensational Jimmy Cabello and his House Rockers and the Big Beat.
Alan Freed's rock films generated massive record sales and kept the movie theaters packed. But not everyone loved this new phenomenon. Religious groups called rock and roll a moral menace.
This rock and roll rhythm is filled with dynamite.
I know the evil feeling that you feel when you sing it. I know the lost position that you get into in the beat. Well, if you talk to the average teenager of today and you ask them what it is about rock and roll music that they like, and the first thing they'll say is the beat.
The 1978 movie American Hot Wax touted Freed as a hero, and even legendary rocker Chuck Berry put in an appearance in memory of his old friend.
1959. The battleground was rock and roll, and a disc jockey named Alan Freed lit the fuse that ignited a nation.
Stand to watch a bunch of kids have a good time, can you?
Yes, I actually worked on the bio based on Alan Freed. It was called American Hot Wax, and it was a flawed movie, but actually better than most. I think in retrospect it holds up pretty well. I think it does capture the essence of rock and roll. I don't think it really captures the essence of Alan Freed. So basically they used Alan Freed to take the fall for all of rock and roll. And it did break his spirit. Basically he lost his job in New York and had to keep taking smaller and smaller jobs. And he drank himself to death.
Look, you can close the show. You can stop me. But you're never going to stop rock and roll, don't you know that?
It was the beginning of an era. You should have been there.
Here is the greatest collection of rock and roll stars in the sizzle and bounce business.
See you later, alligator. After a while, crocodile. Can't you see you?
Soon after their enormous success with Blackboard Jungle, Haley and his Comets released See You Later, Alligator, which would be featured in the film Rock Around the Clock. Rock promoter Alan Freed plays himself as a big band manager who takes a small town band and catapults them to the heights of fame with the new sounds of rock and roll. Haley and his Comets portray the band, performing six of the film's musical numbers. Other groups found instant recognition in small cameos, including the Platters, singing one of their all-time classics. Shot on a small budget and clocking in at a mere 76 minutes, Rock Around the Clock's success came more from its musical talents than from any actual plotline. Hollywood's influence wasn't limited to the USA. The impact of rock and roll was felt internationally. These rock films helped to spread the music like wildfire.
We quite often have people come to meet us like that, but I think this is the most enthusiastic reception I've ever seen.
Do you get a lift yourself when you hear rock and roll music?
Well, yes, I would say that, John. It makes me feel sort of happy, and I enjoy playing it very much.
Bill Haley had the advantage of being the first spokesman, even though he looked like the grandfather of rock and roll. Unfortunately, he was the forefather, at least as far as appearances go. And so he really did generate a lot of excitement. He was the first rock and roller that most Europeans saw. And when he played Germany, I mean, there were riots.
Rock and roll music was just the outlet that teenagers were looking for. It was a way for them to express themselves and release their frustrations. Finally, here was something they could relate to, a thing to call their own, a world in which adults were not allowed. Sometimes their enthusiasm went out of control. Freed and Haley teamed up once again in 1957's Don't Knock the Rock, a formula film, showcasing the talents of a flamboyant Little Richard.
Little Richard was out of New Orleans, and he basically, as he built himself, he was the king and the queen of rock and roll. I think he was the first rock star to either be publicly gay or pretend to be publicly gay. And when I interviewed him years ago, he said that basically that way he felt he wouldn't be as much of a threat to young America if they thought, here this crazy black man was not really after your daughter, you know. But I don't know if being after your son was any better, particularly. He wrote his own material, was a brilliant pianist, and possibly could be the best, if not the best showman of rock and roll, one of the best.
Hollywood studios began turning out rocksploitation films at a furious pace. Again, it was Alan Freed who led the way in the first truly rock and roll musical film, Rock, Rock, Rock.
Is Tommy taking you to the school prom?
He hasn't asked me yet.
He will. I sure hope I find someone as nice as Tommy.
Oh, you'll meet him someday.
Well, I hope it's before the prom. Are you in love with Tommy?
Well...
Future star Tuesday Weld made her screen debut, lip-syncing to the vocals of Connie Francis.
Someday he'll know you loved him so.
Say, I almost forgot to tell you. Be sure and watch Alan Freed's television program tomorrow night.
I never miss it. What's going to be on tomorrow night?
A surprise.
And here it is, Alan Freed's Rock and Roll Party. And here he is in person, Alan Freed.
Hello, everybody. How y'all? Welcome to our rock and roll jubilee of stars.
And here we go to rockin' with Waylon Tenorman, Freddie Mitchell, and the Rock and Roll Boogie. Here we go.
As bad as the rock movies are, thank God at least people like Frankie Lyman were captured live.
Frankie Lyman, a 13-year-old youngster with a great way with a song, and the Teenagers.
Baby, baby, how I want you. Baby, baby, how I need you. Baby, baby, you're the only one. Two, boom, boom, three, four.
Another rock star who made appearances in teen exploitation films was the legendary Chuck Berry.
The thing that was pure genius about Chuck is that he could write teenage music without it being black or white. So when he would write about teenage America, it was what Chuck did single-handedly is the same thing that Motown did later. It was music for teenage America, you know, not for black America, not for white America.
All the cats wanna dance with sweet little Dixie.
Rock patriarch Big Joe Turner was already a major rhythm and blues star with many hits behind him, but it was Hollywood's silver screen that widened his audience. At 40 years old, Big Joe had become a rock star. Haley never again achieved the heights of fame as he had with Rock Around the Clock. He had been an unlikely rock star from the start, and by 1957, it was even more apparent. He found it difficult to compete with the fresh new faces, particularly a young kid from Memphis named Elvis Presley. Colonel Tom Parker was an ex-carnival advance man who fought hard to become the personal manager to the young Elvis. He used shady con man tactics to mastermind a career that would eclipse all others in the music world. With his big black pompadour, rebellious sneer, and sexually explicit dance moves, it was inevitable that this talent would one day make it to Hollywood. This ex-dog catcher and carnival worker would become a very powerful and rich man.
Colonel Parker took over managing Elvis, that Elvis really became a national phenomenon because Colonel Parker took him off of Sun Records and put him on RCA, gave him incredible TV exposure.
We'd like at this time to introduce you to a young fellow who, like many performers, Johnny Ray among them, come up out of nowhere to be overnight very big stars. This young fellow we saw for the first time while making a movie short. We think tonight that he's going to make television history for you. We'd like you to meet him now, Elvis Presley, and here he is.
Well, get out of that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Get out of that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans.
Elvis came on like a whirlwind, belting out Shake, Rattle, and Roll to a bewildered yet captivated audience.
This was the essence of rock and roll. I mean, a lot of people, in retrospect, attack Elvis for stealing the black music and making it white, but that's as insane as saying the Rolling Stones added nothing. I mean, basically, Elvis Presley, basically, I say, had a black soul with a white face. I mean, he took music and they took it further than anybody had up till then. It was just awesome to watch. It was like an uncaged animal.
Only 3 months after his first television appearance, Elvis dominated the charts, accounting for 50% of RCA Victor's record sales.
He used to talk about James Dean. Both liked Jimmy Dean a lot, and he knew then that someday he was going to be an actor, and he wanted to be an actor like Jimmy Dean.
Speed. Action.
We're gonna move to a better home. Well, there's a hole in the roof where the rain pours in. A hole in the floor where it runs right out again.
Love me tender, love me dear. Tell me you are mine.
I remember seeing Love Me Tender, and it was really hysterical because when Elvis dies at the end, all the males in the audience cheered and all the girls were crying. There was a real schism between the Elvis Presley fanatics. And I remember getting into fights in high school of saying, well, I like Elvis Presley, and I actually get into fist fights over it because, you know, a real man wasn't supposed to admit he liked Elvis. That was just for the girls.
Elvis became a bona fide movie star with his first role in Love Me Tender. The film was originally called The Reno Brothers, but after hearing Elvis sing Love Me Tender, the producers promptly changed the title. Critics panned the film, saying that Presley's acting was wooden and limited, but the fans loved it. Within 3 days of release, Love Me Tender recouped its entire cost, making it a first in Hollywood history. Good acting or not, Hollywood was prepared to bank on Elvis. By now, everyone wanted to cash in on this rock and roll craze. Films such as Rock Baby Rocket boasted unknown rock talents and tried to melt together whatever musical acts they could.
There was this movie, Rock Baby Rocket, which I believe wasn't shot in, I don't think it was shot in Memphis. I think it was shot on a soundstage in Dallas, I believe. It was definitely in Texas, and I think it was just about a one-day shoot where they did everything on this one soundstage with absolutely no locations. Everybody rooga-dooga's all around, rooga-dooga. The other groups in the movie, I, as an expert, never even heard of.
Give you all my money, I give you all my love, I never leave you, baby, I swear to God above, love me, baby.
Rock Baby Rocket really pushed the limit by featuring not the king himself, but the president of the Elvis fan club, Kay Wheeler, dancing her way across the screen.
It's a horrible movie, but the great thing about it is you do see some really wild rockabilly singing from Johnny Carroll, so it's worth it for that alone.
I see my woman, don't you know? She's the one who's going, going, going.
Rock and roll has got to go. And go it does at KWK. We're all through playing rock and roll records. This week is record-breaking week here at KWK. And after this week, no more rock and roll will be played on the air.
There may not have been any more rock and roll on KWK, but there certainly was over in England. Even future authoress Jackie Collins, hogging the camera here in the black dress, had caught the rock and roll bug. Long before the Beatles hit it big in Liverpool, British films used the movies as a vehicle to hype their up-and-coming rock stars. Bands like Tony Crumbie and his Rockets blasted their way onto the silver screen.
Rock and roll really was indigenous to America. Basically, the Brits and the French tried to compete. The French had this guy, Johnny Halliday, who was supposed to be the French Elvis Presley. But, the music just didn't hold up. And the Brits would come up with people like Cliff Richards or Tommy Steele. And basically, they were just poor copies. The British were too reserved. They didn't have the magnetism, the incredible. I think that what made America great with rock and roll was that mixture of black and white. And I think the Brits were just too white. And I think the music was showed in the fact that it was much too vanilla. And it wasn't until the poor Brits, like the ones from Liverpool, came along in the early to mid '60s, when you had like a John Lennon and these people that were from a more impoverished background that grew up on American black records, that the Brits really started showing their own.
Overseas and back in America, Hollywood continued to crank out more spin-offs and low-budget titles showcasing the latest rock talents. Though moviegoers began to grow weary of the formulaic plot lines, one thing kept them coming back for more: their love for rock and roll. Even B-movie master Roger Corman jumped on the rock and roll bandwagon, directing Rock All Night and the equally campy Carnival Man.
In a carnival rockin' with the most casual of rock and roll cats. They live of triangles so sharp, it'll dig you deep.
Cats here to show, it's the teenage fox. And everybody go, go, ooh, shoot the deep.
I've been watching you real good, kid. You got your eyes open for every pair of pants that walks by.
You're just jealous because I've got your job.
The outspokenest, realest facts of life. Set to the songs of tomorrow's brightest rock and roll stars.
Carnival Rock featured basically the only rock and roller was Bob Lumen, who was doing straight rock and roll. And he went on to have a few rock hits and actually a couple of country hits. And David Houston became gigantic in country music later.
Well, we were riding around just digging the scene. I says, come on, baby, let's have some fun. You know, darling, you're my only one.
It's a fire with runaway suspense.
I'll have your heart before the sun comes up.
Oh, what have you?
Elvis returned to the screen in 1957's Loving You. Again, his acting was questioned, but no one could deny that Elvis was at his best when let loose to rock and roll.
Chain around my neck and leave me anywhere. Oh, let me be.
Oh, let him be.
Ooh, Davy Bear.
Follow him through the barnstorming days and the one-night stands, the big moment when the girls discovered him and he discovered girls. See what happens when a down-to-earth kid goes too high, too fast.
It's not my future you care about, it's yours. It's what I can do for you. You don't care about me or Tex or anybody, just yourself.
You've got 15 minutes to get on that stage and find out if you've even got a future.
Loving You was the essence of a great rock and roll movie. I mean, he played this character, Deke Rivers, this poor kid who works his way up through rock and roll and then gets attacked and decides for being too overtly sexual on stage. And then he goes on national TV to defend himself and then does the most overtly sexual number you've ever seen on camera.
The most charismatic, the most magical individual I've ever seen, both off screen, off stage, and on stage, on screen. He's the kind of person that could not walk into a room and not stop whatever was happening in that room. Every person, whether it was a man or a woman, would turn and look at him. It's that magical, you know. There was something about him, and you can't really define it with any kind of vocabulary. Uh-huh. We don't have the words that accurately tell you what that is. It's uh-huh. Magic.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard the knocked out jailbird sing. Let it rock. Everybody let it rock. Everybody in the whole cell block was dancing to the tail out rock.
Vince Everett, dynamically portrayed by Elvis Presley, was a tough blackboard jungle kid. Jailhouse Rock is the astounding success story of this rebel with a voice that rocked the world.
I guess it's just because you were so square.
Baby, I don't care.
Jailhouse Rock is also the love story of this rebel.
How dare you think such cheap tactics would work with me?
Tactics, honey. It's just a beast in me.
The fires of violence still raged in Vince as he fought his way to fame and fortune in the exciting world of popular music.
Don't leave me now.
Jailhouse Rock was better acting and incredible choreography, a lot of which Elvis did himself. Some of the most complex dance scenes Elvis orchestrated totally on his own.
Going through a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, they began to wail.
And then came Hollywood.
Oh, Vince, let's try it again. Vince!
How do you like our movie star, Peggy?
He has adapted very quickly.
Well, there's not much oxygen up where he is, and the man gets lightheaded.
There comes a time when you got to take a hand in things. That time is now.
Don't push me.
I'm going to beat hell out of you.
Don't try. You're talking crazy, man.
You know you got it coming, son.
I said don't try.
Elvis's co-star in Jailhouse Rock was actress Judy Tyler. Her career was just blossoming. But soon after wrapping Jailhouse, Judy was tragically killed in an automobile accident while on her honeymoon. Elvis was devastated at the loss of his new friend, as were millions of moviegoers.
The first four Elvis movies were surprisingly good. Love Me Tender, and then Loving You, and then Jailhouse Rock, and then King Creole. King Creole was his best acting by far, probably the best he did in his entire career.
King Creole was touted as Elvis's finest piece of work. The film allowed Elvis to expand on his acting abilities and prove that he was more than just a simple rock and roll singer. He also had the privilege to be surrounded by several of Hollywood's finest, including famed Casablanca director Michael Curtiz.
I would have loved to hear stories about Errol Flynn and Bogart, but Mr. Curtiz, he just said I looked fat. Well, I stayed off food and did diet pills for 2 weeks and lost 10 pounds.
Ronnie, what are you doing here with this man? How'd you get into this?
How do you get out?
Oh, baby, tells you, stay a while.
Yeah. Well, I said I looked like a real actor. I told the Colonel that's what I wanted to do. If rock and roll were to die out, then I'd try to keep on topping the pictures. That'd be my best chance. And boy, when I get out, after my first picture with Hal Wallace, it's the non-musicals for me.
If he had gotten out there and if the first picture they gave him was like an actor's studio picture with Elia Kazan playing a very close James Dean kind of role, Elvis Presley would not only have been nominated, but he might have won the Academy Award, and he would have had a fantastic career as a serious actor. He was wonderful like that. We used to do scenes together in the dressing rooms and in the car driving places. He was absolutely a great actor.
Sex kitten Mamie Van Doren made a name for herself by heating up the screen in dozens of low-budget rock films.
He's healthy and normal and full of fun. You know what I mean, too. Don't tell me you never rode a hot rod or had a late date in the second balcony. Or maybe you haven't. Yeah!
Teenage movies, which has a big cult following now, especially in Europe.
40 years later, and Mamie is still rocking.
My brain! Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire!
The High School Confidential was one of my favorites, only there wasn't enough rock and roll in it, but it was actually better acting and a better plot than most. But just for that opening scene where they have Jerry Lee Lewis on the back of a flatbed truck doing High School Confidential, I mean, that opening shot is one of the best rock and roll pieces ever captured on film.
You know, for a teacher, pretty cool. Why don't we cut out and go to your pad and live it up, huh?
These are not underprivileged kids from broken homes. Actually, they're the overprivileged. Teenage rebels, too young to be careful, too tough to be afraid.
MGM's High School Confidential not only featured Van Doren, but also showcased the very first inductee into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the killer, Jerry Lee Lewis. No matter what musical trends pass us by, Jerry Lee Lewis is still a rock and roller.
The key thing with Jerry Lee is to see any footage on him from any point of his career. I mean, even when he was older, I mean, as Jerry Lee Bowes, he says, I'm one of the all-time great stylists, like Al Jolson, like Hank Williams. He said, I can take any song and make it mine, and he did. His interpretation was always pure killer, pure Jerry Lee.
In Great Balls of Fire, actor Dennis Quaid portrayed the scandalous rocker on screen.
I remember Great Balls of Fire when it came out. I was in the car with my dad. He turned it up. I was just jumping up and down the back seat. You know, the music turned you on, you know what I mean? Something about it turned you on.
I had never met Dennis prior to the movie a year and a half ago, so when I met him. And he's a fantastic young man. He has to be a hard working physically. He's got to be in there. And brainy wise too, he's a great man. He's done this movie. I didn't think they could do it. I didn't think it would ever be done.
My first responsibility was to Jerry Lee Lewis in doing this role. I wanted to get it as right as I can, try to get to the heart of him. The music is what this movie is about, and it's really what Jerry. You can't separate the two of them.
Yeah.
Kiss me, baby. Woo! Feel good. Hold me, baby.
I love country music. It's God in its way, but God, there's no comparison with rock and roll.
From the onset, Alan Freed had insisted that the original artists be featured in his films. But some thought that rock music was too out of control and sought to clean up its image by doing homogenized cover versions of classics by artists such as Fats Domino and Little Richard.
Pat Boone built his entire career on covering black records just when they started to hit. And if you play his version of Tutti Frutti next to Little Richard's, I mean, it's ludicrous.
I didn't want to record songs like Tutti Frutti and other songs like that that don't make a lot of sense, you know, but the recording director went out, thank goodness. He told me to go ahead and do it because it was going to be a hit. So I said, all right, I didn't believe it, but we went ahead and recorded it anyway.
And it was a hit.
It was a hit.
Ladies and gentlemen, the legendary Fats Domino.
How did you feel when other white folk were doing your hits? Were you complimented or did you think that was bad, like when Pat Boone did it or Ricky Nelson? Or did you find that as a compliment?
I think it was great.
Teen idols like Ricky Nelson tried to give the songs a more wholesome sound and succeeded in doubling record sales for both him and the original artist.
Some of the early TV shows, if you watch the Ozzy and Harriet show, the Ricky Nelson appearances, no matter what you think about Ricky, that was good rock and roll. I mean, and that was the first rock and roll that came into our homes on a regular basis.
I'm gonna run right by your side. For you, pretty baby, I'd even die on one.
All my life, I've been waiting, and I there'll be no hesitating, no boy. When you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that to you.
Buddy was great in person, and a lot of us identified with Buddy more than most, because Buddy was not a good-looking man and wore thick glasses, and in fact, the glasses were his trademark. So a lot of us, not exactly good-looking teenagers, identified more with a Buddy Holly than with an Elvis Presley, because maybe we could be a Buddy Holly, but there was no way on God's earth we could be an Elvis Presley.
Buddy Holly's short-lived life would come to the screen in The Buddy Holly Story, starring Gary Busey. Busey even sang his own vocals over Holly's music.
The town thinks he's ordinary. His parents think he's wasting his time.
Admit, Buddy, we've been mighty patient.
His friends think he's crazy.
What am I gonna do with you?
But Buddy's got something a lot of people want. All my love, all my love. It's called Genius.
Peggy Sue.
Holly, 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 holly.
Peggy Sue. When you say goodbye,
don't say anything like Eddie.
Yo, come on! Come on, that's for real and not fade away.
I think Gary Busey did a top-notch job. And I remember some of the stupid reviewers attacking Busey by saying that Holly never danced around the stage like that. But I saw Buddy Holly live in 57, and Holly did have a long chord on the guitar, and he definitely danced from one side of the stage to the other. So much for the critics.
And my love's bigger than the candlelight.
The Buddy Holly Story.
Well, I tried to show you and you drive me back.
You'll be laughing, crying, singing, and stomping your feet.
Rock and roll almost died in the late 50s. You had a number of simultaneous disasters. Buddy Holly got killed in the plane wreck. Elvis Presley got drafted in 58 and taken off the market for 2 years. Little Richard was on a plane flight and the plane almost crashed, and so he got so scared he saw God and quit rock and roll and became a preacher. So all this was happening simultaneously.
Buddy Holly, 17-year-old Richie Valens, and J.P. Richardson, known as the Big Bopper, were touring the Midwest when their plane went down over an Iowa cornfield. No one made it out alive. Many consider February 3rd, 1959, to be the day the music died.
I didn't want to go to school that day. It was like a relative died to me. It was like, I didn't really know who the Big Bopper or Richie Valens, but Buddy Holly was, maybe because I saw him as a kid, and plus the great records. Buddy Holly really was one of a kind as a musician, as a producer, as a songwriter.
Perhaps the final nail in the coffin was when Alan Freed and Dick Clark were investigated in the infamous Paola scandal.
You'll recall that Congressman Bennett and I insisted that Dick Clark be called here and let's stop talking to the peanut disc jockeys and get the big boy.
I have mentioned to them again and again, and now in public and under oath, I have never taken payola.
We came to a mutual dissolvement of the contract, WNEW and myself.
Well, what about the payola charges?
What payola charges?
Well, that are rife in the industry right now. Have you ever taken payola?
No, I have not.
It was a matter of your personal integrity, I think you said?
Correct.
Do you really think there's room for personal integrity in the rock and roll business the way it's going?
Why not?
I hear virtually every disc jockey took money to play records. It was a very common practice, and there was not really a law against it, per se. And when when the government was trying to attack rock and roll, they figured this is a way to attack it by exposing this semi-illegal practice.
Everyone seemed in the midst of controversy. Jerry Lee Lewis shocked the world when he married his 14-year-old cousin.
Oh, is that so?
Yes, we had a very nice time, and the people treated us real nice.
He made the mistake of marrying his 14-year-old first cousin. The industry couldn't accept, so basically his records were totally blacklisted after that. Here was the great threat. I mean, here was all the stuff they accused rock and roll of. I mean, how degenerate can you be? And Jerry Lee has answered that question.
When were you married?
Pardon?
When were you married?
No personal questions. Well, we leave our personal questions out of this, sir.
All right, well, good luck.
Ever since Elvis shaved his head and joined the service, rock music began to take a serious decline. It seemed that the conservatives and religious leaders' prophecies had come true. Rock and roll music was immoral and would not last. The big question was, would Hollywood and the entertainment world turn its back on rock and roll and look for a safer trend? Or would they simply rock on?
There's a lot of arguments about people who were the father of rock and roll. I have never, ever claimed that title. Somebody said to me, turning that question slightly, what would you want to be remembered as having done in your life? I've done a lot of things I've been very proud of, and I've done some things I'm not so proud of. But I would like it to be remembered in the music annals as when this birth of the new music was there and this generation that was called teenagers was around and rock and roll was born, I assisted at the delivery.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on, join me, hunt.
Rock and roll is a river of music, which has absorbed many streams. Rhythm and blues, jazz, ragtime, cowboy songs, country songs, folk songs, all have contributed greatly to the big beat.